So let's talk about agency, folks. Agency is exceptionally, exceptionally testable. When we're dealing with agency and sub-agency, I want to make sure you understand agency exists in every single state, but some of the stuff that we're teaching you is very specific to North Carolina. Remember that term facilitator or transactional broker. We don't have that in North Carolina. That is where nobody is represented. Okay. There's an agent, right? There's a broker and he's facilitating the deal, but he has loyalties to nobody. You may see that on the national test, but you're not going to see it on the North Carolina test, at least not in the context of something that we will do. When we're dealing with North Carolina, understand this, you have to represent somebody. If you're not representing the buyer, the only other person you can represent is the seller. Those are the options. You can either represent the buyer or the seller or both. If you're not representing anybody, you're not in the deal. Go home, slick. That's how it works. So when we get into this in North Carolina, one of the things to remember, and this is very, very testable, there are two different ways, really and truthfully, that a consumer could hire a real estate broker. More often than not, what they're doing is they're hiring a broker who works for a firm. When that happens, who they're actually hiring is the firm. If I work for Coldwell Banker, Miriam was to hire me. Well, she actually hired Coldwell Banker. And I'm considered a sub-agent of Coldwell Banker. Sub-agent is just that terminology that means the agent of the agent. 99% of relationships are a consumer hiring a firm and the individual licensees act as extensions of the firm. But the other way that the relationship could happen is a consumer could hire an individual broker directly, but you've got to default to the firm. 99% of the questions on your test are going to be about the firm. But if you see the word sole proprietor or sole practitioner, now that's changed the relationship. There is no firm. There's only one broker. And that would change a lot of things. If Miriam signs a listing agreement with me and I work for Coldwell Banker and I die, the listing agreement is alive and well because it was never about me. It was about Coldwell Banker. If Miriam signed a listing agreement with me, a sole proprietor working independently, and I die, our listing agreement is now dead because I'm it. It was just me. You may see something on your test trying to trick you that says, well, what happens if Miriam signed a listing agreement with Seth Chauncey, sole proprietor broker? You may get an option that says, well, the real estate commission will transfer to somebody else. No, they won't. The real estate commission is an oversight agency. They don't give two craps about people dying and agency. What's going to happen is Miriam's just going to have to go find a new agent. I'm gone. She's got to find somebody else. But if I'm with a firm, the firm is alive and well. They'll just reassign it to another agent within the firm. Never, ever, ever assume sole proprietor. We would have to give you information to say sole proprietor, sole practitioner. Otherwise, we're dealing with the firm. When we're dealing with the firm, that's what makes dual agency such a unique concept. If you look at dual agency, what we define dual agency as is the buyer and the seller are represented in the same transaction by the same agent. Well, the agent is the firm. ABC Realty has both the buyer and the seller trying to purchase this one house. It is the same house, right? Because it's the same deal. They're going to try to give you options of which of the following is an example of dual agency. And it's going to say a firm that works with buyers and sellers. No, almost every firm works with buyers and sellers. It's not dual agency. Unless they're working with a buyer and the seller in the same transaction, the same house. That is dual agency. If I'm working with a buyer who wants to buy 123 Main Street, and I'm also working with a seller that's selling 223 Walnut Street, I'm working with a buyer and a seller. I'm the firm, but they're different. I'm giving exclusive seller representation to the seller, and I'm giving exclusive buyer representation to the buyer. So dual agency arises when the firm is representing the buyer and the seller in the same transaction. In this kind of transaction, it does not matter if there's one licensee or two licensees, because it's never about that. Christina is working with the buyer and Myra is working with the seller, and they both work for ABC Realty. It does not matter that there's two agents. They are useless. They can't help either party. Who is the agent for the seller? ABC. Who is the agent for the buyer? ABC. We don't care about Christina and Myra. If Myra helps her seller gain an advantage over the buyer. ABC has hurt the buyer. If Christina helps the buyer gain an advantage over the seller, ABC has hurt the seller. We do not allow that to happen. So if it's just dual agency, you are worthless. You are holding hands and singing kumbaya. You cannot relay any information. The buyer asks Christina, I want to get a good deal. What should I offer on this house? What is the only thing that Christina can say to the buyer? I don't know. What do you want to offer? And then once she comes to terms with what she wants to offer and they send it over to the seller and the seller looks at Myra and say, Myra, what should I do with this? And Myra's going to say, I don't know. What do you want to do with it? Do you want to accept it? You can't give any advice. What if the firm has two offices, agent one and one office, agent two in a different, is it dual? The answer is absolutely. If you look at the real estate commission's website, I'm going to give you a real world example. This is our sister company, which is Coal Banker Seacoast Advantage. Coal Banker Seacoast Advantage has like 25 offices, however many this is a lot of them. This right here, folks, is called a firm license number, which means every single one of these offices are the same firm. So if you have an agent on this Jacksonville office doing a deal against an agent in this Carolina Beach office, that's dual agency. Every office has to have its own BIC. So let me answer another important testable question for you. The rules of when you can't do designated, okay? Remember what designated looks like. In designated, we go for blood. This is the Working with Real Estate Agents brochure, Q&A brochure. And they gave it as a visual to help you understand this. So if you have two firms, Coal Banker, Keller Williams, it will never, ever, 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 ever be dual agency. We call that cooperating brokerage. That's what this picture is showing. Here's one firm in red, one firm in blue. We're going for blood. Dual agency, we just told you, it can be one sole practitioner or one licensee holding hands with everybody. Can't hurt one over the other. That makes good sense. It would not make sense if you knew all the secrets of the seller and all the secrets of the buyer and you had loyalties to both, who do you help? No one. Because if you do, you've screwed somebody. Works the exact same way with two licensees. So here's that example we just gave you, right? Christina and Myra holding hands, can't say nothing. But then designated is where we've drawn this line. And that's where the BIC said, Myra, you go for blood for the seller. Christina, you go for the blood for the buyer. We put boxing gloves on you. We throw you in the ring together, right? And we yell, go for the kidneys. Everybody else is in the sideline eating popcorn. That is designated dual agency. Most firms default to designated as long as it's legal. The only times we don't do designated is if it's illegal. And there are two, really three times that you cannot do designated. Time number one is if you've already received confidential information about the opposite party. These relationships happen at random and arbitrary times. If Myra's working with a seller, she could have been working with this person for 40 days and her house is still on the market. And then Christina could have found a brand new buyer and just started working with her today. Doesn't matter. It would still be dual agency because they both work for the same firm. If in the 40 days that Myra's working with this seller, she blabbed her mouth to Christina talking about price, terms, and motivation of the seller. And Christina found this buyer who said, I want to put an offer on 123 Main Street. Now, Christina has already received confidential information about the seller, and Christina could not be a designated agent against them because that would not be fair. So that is one time where designated dual would be illegal. Could they do the deal as dual agents? Yes, they could, just not designated dual agents. Could we also remove Christina and put somebody else in as a designated agent? Sure, we could. So there's number one. You cannot do designated dual agency if you've already received confidential information about the other party. Rule number two is you cannot do designated dual agency against your broker in charge. Every single office has their own BIC, broker in charge. If agent A was a provisional broker under this fine person right here, they could do a designated dual agency deal against John Hoops because John Hoops may be a BIC, but John Hoops is not their BIC. Leontine is their BIC. So the rule is you cannot do designated dual agency against your BIC. So your BIC could help you go for blood against this BIC. And that would be fine because we're doing designated. Agent A could not, as a provisional broker, do a designated dual agency deal against Leontine Zambrano because that's their BIC. Could Agent A do dual agency with Leontine Zambrano? Yes, they could. Notice the difference. I said, do dual agency with. Can they be in dual agency together? Absolutely. Folks, lest you remember what dual agency looks like. We're holding hands. It doesn't matter who is who because we're singing Kumbaya. Be very careful. The test is going to try to trick you. Can a provisional broker and their bank be in a dual agency deal together? Yes. But can they do a designated deal against each other? No. See, that one word makes a huge difference. Designated is just a type of dual. It's an in-house transaction where we're representing the buyer and the seller in the same transaction. Designated is the same thing, but now we're going for blood. One agent is going for blood for the buyer. One agent is going for blood for the seller. It works just like cooperating brokerage, but it's an in-house transaction. A provisional broker under John Hoops and another provisional broker under John Hoops could do designated against each other. A full broker and a full broker, a PB and a full broker. The only rule is a provisional broker cannot go against their BIC in designated. That's the only rule. The rule actually states that the broker in charge cannot go against their provisional broker. So technically, it would be the broker in charge that would have to remove themselves, not the PB that would have to remove themselves. But your broker in charge cannot go against you in designated dual agency. But every other combination is fair game. A full broker can do designated dual agency against their BIC. As a full broker, I could do designated dual agency against my BIC, no problem. The only rule is a BIC against their provisional broker. And that's a no-go. These are very confusing concepts, folks, but you've just got to be very careful. Sometimes they won't say dual agency, though. What they may say is Christina is working with a seller and Christina works for ABC Realty. Myra is working with a buyer and Myra works for ABC Realty. They're going to name the same firm. That's going to tell you it's dual agency. Now, don't ever assume designated, right? If they go in to say, you know, they've both gotten permission to exclusively represent their client for their best interest, what are they probably practicing? That'd be designated dual agency. But if they're not been given that permission, just default it to dual. Dual versus designated dual, very, very different things.
If you like this video, feel free to share it with a friend. For more real estate education content, please subscribe to the channel. From all of us at Seacoast Real Estate Academy, thank you for watching.